CMU to also give a talk on multi-speaker recognition. So let me introduce Dr. Jinyu Li. So Jinyu Li is right now a partner applied scientist and technical lead in Microsoft collaboration. So previously he received his PhD at Georgia Tech, advised by Professor Qinghui Li. So Jinyu, even the student, when he was a student, he also received a best paper award from InterSpeech on his work for margin estimation. But for today, right now it's a deep learning age. So Jinyu, coming from another perspective, will introduce his work. So Jinyu, please take over.
Thanks, Huck, for the introduction. It's really my honor to come back and introduce the recent works. And my topic is recent advance in end-to-end automatic speech recognition. And I also need to thank lots of my Microsoft colleagues for the contribution of the talk. And a little about me. I studied at CSIP from 2004 to 2008, so I'm just coming back home. And at that time, my advisor is Professor Qinghui Li. I learned a lot from Professor Li. I still remember all those great time, and the study of in Georgia Tech indeed helped my career a lot. And also, I learned a lot from all the great professors at CSIP at that time, especially Professor John and Professor Clements, who work on the speech. Right now in Microsoft, I mainly develop technology for Microsoft to always have the world-class ASR products. Currently, I'm leading the end-to-end ASR efforts. In the speech community, from 2017, I'm the member of the IEEE Speech and Language Processing Technical Committee, and I was also serving as the associate editor of the IEEE Transaction for Speech for several years. Okay, in this talk, I will talk two parts. One is just the E2E ASR fundamental, because I know that not all the audience come from the speech background. So I will briefly introduce CTC, AED, and RNT, all these kind of popular end-to-end models. And then I will talk about advanced. I need to clarify that when I talk about this kind of advanced, it's not only the work from Microsoft. I will cover the most significant works, I believe, in the industry or in the community. Four aspects: encoder, multilingual adaptation, and advanced models. Okay, let's first look at the E2E fundamental. This is the flow chart of the conventional automatic speech recognition. We have the input speech. We go through this kind of feature extraction to generate the feature XN, and we need to build an acoustic model, language model, and word lexicon. Then we have this kind of pattern classification or decoding that we use to combine all these models together to generate the final recognition results, hey, Cortana, for example. And if we look back to the ASR breakthroughs after 2000, the first breakthrough definitely is from GM to DNN happened around 12 years ago. At that time, we do is that we just replace the Gaussian mixture likelihood evaluation in the acoustic model with DNN. And I think before the time of DNN, we still have lots of commercialized speech recognition products, but the accuracy is not always good. But after the DNN, we can see now the speech recognition products or systems are very good. So you just use it every day in your daily life, for example, with the voice typing and so on. The next breakthrough is even more fundamental. It just happened in the recent few years. We just replace this kind of acoustic model, language model, lexical model, and so on with just a single end-to-end model. Here, I still keep this kind of feature extraction block because this one is really lightweight. In theory, we can also replace this one or just remove it and just do this kind of directly from input speech to the ASR output results or word sequence. Let's look at the comparison between the conventional hybrid model and the E2E model. For the hybrid model, we just have separate model trained. Then they are used all together during the testing in an ad hoc way. For example, here we have acoustic model just modeling the likelihood of the phoneme sequence given the speech signal. We have the language model the probability of the word sequence, and the lexical model decompose the word sequence into the phoneme sequence. In contrast, E2E model is much simpler. We just have a single model directly maps the speech waveform or speech signal into the target word sequence. Therefore, if you look at the current, for example, the papers in speech conference, now E2E models just dominate. There are lots of advantages of E2E models. The first one is that E2E models just use a single objective function, which is consistent with the ASR objective. The second is that E2E models directly output characters or even words, greatly simplifying the ASR pipeline. And also, E2E models are much more compact than the traditional hybrid models. And they can be deployed to devices with high accuracy and low latency, and of course, low footprint. If we look at the current status, E2E models achieve the state-of-the-art results in most benchmarks in terms of ASR accuracy. However, if you look at the industry, hybrid models indeed still dominate lots of commercial ASR systems. The reason is that when we work in industry, ASR accuracy is not the only metrics we look at. There are other lots of factors such as streaming latency, adaptation capability, and so on. The hybrid models are fully optimized for decades for all these kind of challenges. Therefore, if we need to really just commercialize E2E models everywhere in industry, we need more works. In this talk, I will just overview the popular E2E models with the focus of technologies addressing those challenges from industry perspective. These are three most popular E2E models. They are from the left to right, they are CTC, AED, and RNT. Next, I will talk them one by one. The first model is the CTC model. We can see the structure is very simple. It's the first and the simplest E2E ASR model. For the ASR, usually we have this kind of thing. The length of input speech is much longer than the length of a target label. Therefore, blank label is introduced, and we insert blank labels and allow this kind of label repetition in order to have the same length of the CTC path and the speech input sequence. And then the probability of the labels given the observation X is just the sum of all the probability of the CTC path. Q is just one of the CTC paths. And CTC is famous for its this kind of frame independence assumption. It's not a good assumption if we look at this formulation. So the probability of the CTC path given the observation indeed is just the product of all the probability at every frame. Because of that reason, CTC is not used too much in industry for the previous several years. Until recently, it revives with the transformer encoder and the emerged self-supervised learning. The reason is that the transformer encoder is very powerful to cover all the contexts, and the self-supervised learning can learn something beyond acoustical. Sometimes it learns this kind of semantic representation. Therefore, it can help to reduce the this kind of issue of frame independency assumption. Okay, next is the AED model. We can see the structure is now much more complicated. We have the encoder, it converts the input feature sequence into high-level hidden feature sequence. And then we have the attention module. It just computes the attention weights to generate a context vector CU as a weighted sum of the encoder output. And finally, we have the decoder. It just takes the previous output label together with the context vector CU to generate the output YU given the input speech sequence together with the predict labels until the current step. And here, if we calculate the probability of the label sequence given the speech observation, now it's just calculated in an autoregressive way. And always because this probability YU is conditional on all the previous labels. And therefore, we just remove the frame independency assumption. In industry, one very important factor indeed is the streaming. Most of the commercial setup needs the ASR system to be streaming with low latency. Streaming means that the ASR system needs to produce the recognition results at the same time as the user is speaking. Of course, there is some scenario, this kind of non-streaming ASR, but it's not practical for most of the ASR scenarios because the speech signal usually comes in a continuous mode without segmentation. If you want to do the non-streaming ASR, you first need to segment your speech or your audio, and then apply your model. Because AED model has this kind of full attention on the this kind of speech sequence, it may not be ideal to ASR because the speech signal and the output label sequence, and they are monotonic. Therefore, in industry, there are a lot of this kind of study of the streaming AED work. For example, the Mocha method and the trigger attention method, they just apply attention on chunk of input speech instead of the full speech sequence. However, I have to say, all these kind of streaming AED methods are not a natural design for streaming. That's the reason in industry right now, the most dominating the E2E models is the RNT model. In several years ago, we see lots of publication with the AED model, but now more and more publications go to the INT model because it provides a natural way for streaming ASR. Let's look at the INT model. It also has three components. It has encoder, it converts the input feature sequence into the high-level hidden feature sequence. And it has the prediction network. It produces the high-level representation based on the previous label. And the joint network combines the output from encoder and the prediction network together to produce the probability of YU given the speech sequence until the current time t and all the previous label. Because as I mentioned, the RNT is very important, I want to show you how the RNT generates the output tokens. For example, in the beginning, when we initialize the model, we have this kind of X1 as the input speech frame and the blank as the input to the prediction network, and we generate a blank. And we have something called RNT path. We move either horizontally or vertically. When we move horizontally, we just consume a new frame. For example, here, X2, but we still output blank label. If we move vertically, here we can see we just generate the output label H, but still stay at the speech frame X2. And then if we move horizontally, we consume a new frame X3. And here, because we already predict the label H, we put H here as the input to the prediction network and produce blank. If we still move horizontally, we consume X4 as the new speech frame and output blank label. And next, if we move vertically, we produce a new label E. And the next, again, we move horizontally, we put E as the input to the prediction network and output blank label. Next, we stay at the frame X5 and output the label Y. And then last, again, we move horizontally, consume the speech frame X6 and output blank label. In this way, we generate a RNT path from the left bottom corner to the upper right corner. During the RNT training, indeed, we have lots of RNT paths to generate the label sequence HEY. Hey. For example, we also can have this kind of red path. Every path just goes through this kind of grid from the left bottom corner to the upper right corner. And for the RNT training, we are given the label sequence with the length U and acoustical frames with the length T. We just generate this U by T softmax. And the training maximizes the probability of all the RNT paths together. Okay, I want to summarize the E2E models here. CTC has the issue of this kind of independence assumption, but the AED RNT model, they don't have. Of course, attention is a very powerful method, but only AED has this kind of attention and it attends the full sequence. In order to do the streaming, it needs additional work. In contrast, CTC and RNT, they can naturally do the kind of streaming. And because of that reason, AED, usually this kind of ideal scenario is just offline. Another thing is that because AED has this kind of attention, if it's given very long utterance, it attends just everywhere. That means the attention is diffused. Therefore, it's weak to handle this kind of long form utterance. when you look at this kind of a table comparison, indeed, it's easier to reach this kind of conclusion. RMP is the most popular E2E model, at least now, in industry, which requires streaming ASR. Okay, next, let's look at the E2E at once. The first topic is the encoder. If we look at all these kind of E2E models, we can clearly say there is one common component, that's the encoder. Given RNP as an example, for this encoder, we can use LSTM, or transformer, or even conformer. This is the formulation of LSTM. It was proposed in 1997, and it was popular for lots of years. So basically, the output of this LSTM cell HT is conditioning on the input XT and the previous step output HT meta 1. And therefore, this is a recurrent one. And in 2017, there is a very famous paper called Attention is All You Need. This paper proposes this kind of transformer structure. As in the right side, the most important component is called multi-head attention. It has a multiple self-attention module. What a self-attention does, indeed, it computes the attention distribution over the input speech sequence. Here, we have WQ, WK and WV matrix. They are the matrix corresponding to query key and value. We first use the this formulation to generate the query and the key and compute the attention weight, and then combine all the value vector together to generate the output of this layer. For the multi-head self-attention, it just applies multiple parallel self-attentions on the input sequence. Therefore, the modeling is more powerful. And transformer is really good at capturing global context, but less effective in extracting local patterns. In contrast, CNN, which is very famous in the image processing, works very well on the local information. Therefore, conformer was proposed to combine the transformer with CNN. As this flowchart, we can see here convolution block is inserted, and the convolution block is constructed with these multiple layers. Okay, let's go back to industry. Transformer is really powerful, but the industry has its own requirement. We really want the transformer to be streaming with low latency and low computation cost. The vanilla transformer fails to do so because it also attends the full sequence. Therefore, there are lots of solutions. I'm just introducing one solution. Let's call the attention mask is all you need. What we do indeed is that we just change the attention weight matrix by inserting the binary attention mask. And in this way, we can just attend partial of the input speech sequence. After we compute the alpha t tau, the attention weight again, we just apply it to the value vector to generate the output. This attention mask is all you need, can be configured for all kinds of scenarios. For example, for the vanilla transformer, it attends the full utterance. Therefore, if we just want to predict the output at the 10th frame, what we do is that we just attend all the frames at every layer, and the attention mask value is 1 for all the elements. However, of course, this one is not streamable because it looks at a full utterance. Next, if we want to do the streaming recognition, definitely we can just predict the tensor frame output only using all the previous frames. And this is the attention mask matrix. For this kind of method, there is one issue. The issue is that the memory and the runtime cost increase linearly with the length of history. Especially if you have very long utterance, the cost is very high. Therefore, another fix is that at every layer, we just attend limited history. Here, in this example, at every layer, we just attend three history frames. But because of this kind of context expansion, this frame also attend three previous history. And because transformer usually has a large number of layers, for example, 18, 24, and so on. Therefore, even at every layer, we just attend three frames. We still can attend very long history up to, for example, 72 frames if we have 24 layers. In this way, we have low computation cost and low memory cost. Sometimes, in some scenario, we can also allow some small amount of latency. That means we can look at a few frames. Then we can get even better accuracy with this kind of solution. The idea is that right now we have one chunk here. Inside the chunk, this frame can look at all the frames inside the chunk. Therefore, if we want to predict the tensor frame output, it can look at the two frames. In this way, we can have higher accuracy and a lower computation cost and a low memory. Okay, next, let's talk about multilingual. Can you guess in the world, what's the percentage of people can speak only 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 class languages fluently? The answer is that 40% of people can only speak one language. 43% of people, they are bilingual. 13% of people, they are trilingual users. Only 3% of people can speak 4 languages fluently. And 0.1% of people can speak 5 plus languages fluently. Here we have one question. Human cannot recognize all the languages in the world. Can we just build a single high quality multilingual model on device to serve all the users? If we can do this, we know that the device name is 3PO. Okay, let's look at how traditional system handles this challenge. Basically, we have the input speech sequence, and we build for every language, we have the acoustical model and the language model. And in this example, we have 5 models altogether. And in the beginning, the system just decode the input speech with 5 models from each language. And then we also have a language ID here. At some time, the language ID system decides, okay, I'm now confident which language the user is speaking. Then it makes a decision and after that time, people or the system can just switch to one set of this kind of acoustical and language model for the decoding. This kind of system size scales up linearly with the number of languages. Therefore, it can only stay in cloud. And it also heavily depends on the AI ID, the language ID system. If you want to make a reliable decision, you will introduce significant latency. In theory, it's very easy to do in the E2E system. For example, we have the RNT here. We just have the input speech. We just train this system with all the languages. Ideally, the output should handle all this kind of language. If you speak English, the output is just English word. And if you speak German, the output is just German word sequence. Okay, let's look at the multilingual E2E model. As I mentioned, the easiest one is just the monolingual ASR. We build the ENUS ASR model, ZHCN ASR model, and the DEDE ASR model to recognize each individual language. And as I also mentioned, we can just pull all the language data together to build just a single ASR model, and it can handle the input from all the languages. However, pulling all the language data together indeed is a double-edged sword. It maximizes the sharing between languages, and we can have one model for all languages. This is very good. On the other hand, it also introduces the confusion between languages. It's not guaranteed that if we speak English, the ASR model will only output the English word sequence. To address this kind of, to reduce this confusion, definitely people have tried to use this kind of language ID as the input to the ASR model. In this way, the language ID can guide you, guide the system to say, okay, now my input is English, you should output the English word sequence. Definitely, this kind of model improves accuracy. However, it's more like a monolingual model again, because if you are using language ID, you require the prior knowledge of the language to speak. You need to know, always need to know, which language the user will speak. And this is not good for the multilingual user. This person cannot always switch this kind of languages. And this is an example to show what's the gap between the multilingual model without this kind of language ID and with language ID. We can clearly see in average, the gap is very large. Then people may think, okay, how about I just build a specific model for every combination of languages in order to serve, for example, bilingual users. Then for this kind of languages, I build a Spanish and a French bilingual model. I build a Spanish and a Italian bilingual model. And finally, I build a French and a German bilingual model. However, the development cost is terrible. For example, if we have 10 languages, if we want to build a bilingual model for every combination, we need to build 45 bilingual models. And if we want to build a trilingual model for every combination, we need to have 120 trilingual models. This is not affordable even in industry. Our solution is called a configurable multilingual model. What we do is that we still pull all the data together. We just train one model. And during deployment, depending on the user selection, the user have this kind of user selection vector, choice vector. It inputs into our model, and then the model can be configured as different models and generate ASR output. This is the basic design. In this configurable multilingual model, we have a universal module. It models the sharing across all the languages. At the same time, for each language, we have the expert module. It just models the literature from the universal module for each language. Because it handles the literature, usually it just requires much less parameters. Therefore, the overall model size is not too much larger than the universal module. And during the training, we just send to this model with all kinds of combination of user language choice vector here. And during deployment, depending on the user selection, for example, if user input this language choice vector as 10010, what the model knows is that the user indeed can only speak English and Spanish, and this configure model is just configured like this way. And next, for another user, if the user specifies the choice vector as 010011, then the model is configured to just recognize Germany, Spanish, and Italian. In this way, we end up with a high quality and a multilingual model for all kinds of multilingual users. Next, let's talk about.
Sorry.
Okay.
I have a quick question.
Yeah.
For the slide, in the previous slide, the slide after this one, before this one, sorry.
This one?
Sorry, before this one, about the local config.
Let me see. This one?
Yes, about the user selection. So
yeah.
Is that one trainable or is not trainable? Is how this
trainable. This one is totally depending on the user, right? For example, if I want to select, maybe Andreas is a good example. If he wants to use this system, he will just set we provide the user interface, and he will just check Germany and English, German and English, for example. Then the system just generates this kind of user language choice vector.
I see. So it's kind of a universal model, but in the local deployment, you introduce this like symbiotic logic behind to improve this kind of multilingual scenario.
Yeah. Otherwise, if we don't use all the kind of language experts, we don't use user language choice vector, we still can use this kind of universal model to recognize all the languages. However, as I mentioned, because this model doesn't have any prior knowledge of the user, it cannot provide a better accuracy than a model with all this kind of user knowledge.
I see. So, sorry for the previous slide.
Mm-hmm.
So, in this sense, this user selection is kind of on the product, the user will make this selection.
Yes. If you go to, if this system is very well designed, usually it will give you user interface to select which language you can speak.
Yeah, the language preference, right? Yeah.
Yeah.
I see. Do you also think, just a short comment, so, so this look like a really large prediction model, but there has some symbiotic predefinition by the user behind. Do you also think this kind of symbiotic inference, like this Rosy circuit, can be also trainable or is complicated?
We prefer that, because this is just a user choice vector, right? This one should be determined by the user.
I see. Yeah.
Yeah. Gotcha. Yeah.
Cool.
Okay.
I'm good. Yep. Thanks.
Cool. Next, let's talk about adaptation. Indeed, I believe this is a real, really important topic if we want to apply the E2E model successfully in the industry application. Because with the adaptation, usually we see huge accuracy improvement. And the hybrid models, they have been optimized for decades with all these kind of this kind of scenarios. Therefore, we have to put a lot of research efforts in the adaptation. There are three kinds of adaptation. One is speaker adaptation. It just adapts ASR models to better recognize a target speaker's speech. The second one is domain adaptation. It adapts ASR models to the target domain, which has a content mismatch from the source domain. And the last one is called customization. It leverages context such as context, location, music playlist of a specific user to significantly boost the accuracy of this user. Okay, for the speaker adaptation, the biggest challenge is the adaptation data, the amount from the target speaker from the target speaker indeed is usually very small. The solutions indeed can be just shared with all these kind of solutions for hybrid model. For example, we can have this kind of regularization technique such as KL divergency, map adaptation, or EWC. And we can also do the kind of multitask learning because for the E2E model, the output is the what usually the most popular one is the word piece model with the thousands or tens of thousands output units. Then with limited amount of adaptation data, it may not cover all the word piece, but it's really easy to cover, for example, characters. In English, we just have 26 characters, for example. Therefore, we can just build the second branch as the character output and do the multitask learning to improve the model. And another popular trend right now is this kind of using multi-speaker TTS to expand the adaptation set for the speaker. We just synthesize more adaptation data from the speaker with the TTS. Therefore, with more data, the model can be adapted even better. More importantly is this topic, domain adaptation. The biggest challenge for E2E model when we do this kind of domain adaptation is that it's not easy to get enough paired speech and text data in the new domain. For the hybrid model, it's very easy because it has language model. You just need to adapt that language model. Therefore, current solution for the domain adaptation is that we just utilize the new domain text data. The easiest way is that we just do the language model fusion. We build an external language model trained with the new domain text data, and we fuse the E2E model with the external language model using the log linear interpolation. And the most popular one is called a straddle fusion. However, this kind of method is not mathematically grounded because inside the E2E model, there is also some internal language model component. Therefore, people begin to propose this kind of Bayesian methods. Remove the internal language model contribution when fusing an external language model. However, when we do this kind of language model fusion, we need to have an external language model. That means we add some computation cost and we add a footprint. This is not friendly to device. Another way is just to adapt the E2E model with just TTS data generated from the new domain text. This method right now is very popular in industry. However, they also have several drawbacks. The first one is that PTS speech is different from the real speech. It sometimes even degrades the recognition accuracy on real speech. The second is that the speaker variation in the TTS data is far less than that in the large-scale ASR training data. For example, we have millions of users in our ASR training data. And the last one is that the cost of training a multi-speaker TTS model and the generation of the TTS speech from the model is large. Therefore, we propose this kind of data splicing method for domain adaptation. Instead of using TTS synthesize, what we do is that we just look back at the original ASR training data. In the target domain, if we want to have one utterance or one audio with the content Cortana, closed door, we just look back at the existing audio and get the Cortana, closed door segments out from three separate utterances and concatenate them together. And in this way, we don't need any TTS audio. And this method indeed is much simpler and efficient. And sometimes we even don't like to generate any audio to adapt our RNT model or E2E model. So let's look at this kind of RNT structure. We say, okay, the prediction network only condition on the predicted label or the previous labels. Can we just treat it as a language model? If that's the case, we can just use the new domain tag data to adapt the prediction network, and then our RNT model can be adapted. The answer is no, because the prediction network doesn't fully function as a language model because it needs to predict both the standard labels and the blank. Therefore, recently we just proposed this kind of factorized neural transducer. Here, we can see in the left side, we still have this kind of standard RNT structure, but only just predict the blank label. In the right side, we have this dashed box. This dashed box functions exactly like a traditional neural language model. And it can just predict this kind of YU given all these kind of previous labels. But at the same time, this output is combined with the encode output together to predict the standard labels. And then this one is functioning like a traditional RNT loss. In this way, we just can adapt this dashed box with text-only data. And this kind of adaptation is more powerful and very efficient. Next, let's look at the customization. If we build an English ASR system, it usually cannot recognize the contact names of a Chinese person. Therefore, we just present the contact list of this Chinese person to the English ASR system, and the ASR output can be biased toward the contact names. And this kind of biasing is even more effective when designed with the context activation phrase, such as call somebody, email somebody, and text somebody. And this is just an example of how we do the customization. And there are several context biasing models. The first one is that, for example, let's look at the standard AED model. It just takes the acoustical or speech signal, pass it into the encoder, and then do the attention and the decoder, and so on. If we want to do this kind of context biasing, people will add this kind of phrase list here, and we have a context encoder to generate this kind of hidden sequence or embedding for the phrase list. And now the decoder takes two contextual vectors. One is from the speech signal, one is from phrase list. This method is really effective for small phrase list. However, it's very challenging for the bias attention module to focus if the biasing list is too large. For example, if you have phrase list with more than 1,000 entries, the attention is just diffused. It attends every phrase. Therefore, a new method called contextual spelling correction was proposed. This is a post-processing method. We already generated the ASR hypothesis, and we also have this kind of phrase list. And we generated the embedding and go through this kind of self-attention and as the input of a decoder to generate the final ASR output. There is a question why this kind of method can be successful. This is because we have a filtering method. We just use the ASR hypothesis to trim down this kind of large phrase list into a relatively small one so that the attention can perform very well. We cannot easily do in the previous model because we don't have this kind of ASR hypothesis to trim down this kind of phrase list. But because we here for the post-processing, because we are doing post-processing, we already have the ASR hypothesis. We can easily trim down the phrase list depending on the hypothesis. Okay, next, let's quickly talk about the advanced models. The first one is called a non-autoregressive model. If you look at the formulation of AED or RNT, they operated in a left to right manner. The probability of the observation, the label sequence given the speech sequence is just probability of all these kind of YU given the Y1 to U minus one, right? And the speech sequence. For this one, the output label is generated one by one. The decoding is slow, but mathematically is more accurate. Therefore, it has high accuracy. Recently, people begin to propose this kind of non-autoregressive model. It generates all the target tokens simultaneously. And the formulation is here. We can see the probability now is just a product of probability to predict the YU label given the full speech sequence. This one doesn't depend on any other previous predicted label. Therefore, the decoding can be done just with one shot. So we have fast decoding speed, but usually it has slightly low accuracy. Another solution is this kind of mask CTC. It just predicts a set of mask tokens conditioned on the observed token. Here, for example, mask label is just the probability of the mask label given the observation and the speech sequence. It's just the product of Y given all these kind of observation. An example is that we have the speech signal, we go through the transformer encoder and go through the CTC generated output CAP. Then we look at the label and we found that, okay, the A character has low confidence. Then we just mask it and then the masked sequence goes through the transformer decoder together with the encoder output to generate the predicted label U. And finally, we generate the token sequence CUP. In this way, we don't need to predict all the these kind of labels at the same time. We just predict all these kind of low confidence labels at the same time. And Another work is called a unified model. This model is just trained once, but deployed in multiple scenarios. This is very important in industry because we usually deploy model to different scenarios with different kind of computation cost requirement or latency requirement. People can use this kind of dual mode. It just unifies this kind of streaming and non-streaming modes. And people can only have this kind of dynamic encoder. We just adjust dynamically this kind of computation cost during inference. And people can also propose this kind of variable context encoder configured for different latency requirement at the runtime. Briefly, I can give you an example. For example, this kind of a dynamic encoder training, the model has six layers, but during training, we have this kind of layer drop out. And then during decoding, if there is strict computation cost requirement, people can just use this kind of pruned encoder with just three layers. For some scenarios, in the beginning, we just use this kind of pruned encoder. And then during the remaining of the utterance, people use the full encoder. And this is called a dynamic encoder during decoding. And another important model is the two-pass model. Usually, the first pass RNT model definitely is very good at streaming. It provides immediate ASR results. But later, people use a second pass AED model. It just look at the whole utterance, and it can provide better accuracy. With some engineering trick, people can feel that, oh, the second pass result is just produced immediately after the first pass, then the perceived latency is slow, is small. But as I mentioned, AED model is not good at handling this very long utterance. Therefore, recently, people also proposed this kind of cascade model. In the first pass, we have the casual RNT model. It produces immediate results. And in the second pass, on top of this casual RNT encoder, we have the non-casual encoder and to produce the even better accuracy. And because of limited time, I will skip this kind of multi-talk models because Park told me that Xinju will talk about this multi-talk model in next week. So I will just skip all these kind of multi-talk models, and I will also skip the multi-channel models. The idea is very simple, just use transformer to replace the beamforming in the microphone array. And here is the conclusion. In this talk, we overview the E2E models and the practical technology that enable E2E model to potentially replace hybrid models everywhere. We talk about the encoder. Transformer just replaced the STM because we, in industry, we require this kind of low latency and low computation cost. We have to use the attention mask. And we talk about a multilingual model. We just present a configurable multilingual model, which can be trained only once, but can be configured to any multilingual user. And we talk about a very important topic, adaptation. For the domain adaptation, we can use language model fusion, TTS adaptation, splicing data, and fragmentize the neural transducer to do this kind of work. For customization, we talk about the contexture biasing model and the contexture spreading correction model. And I also briefly talk about the advanced models such as a non-autoregressive model with faster decoding speed and a unified model trained only once but can be deployed to different scenarios and the two-pass model, which has low latency, low perceived low latency together with high accuracy. Finally, let's look at the training. The first thing is how to leverage language model training text data. Because E2E models mainly use paired speech and text data. However, if we look at the hybrid model, the speech, paired speech and text data is only used to train acoustic model. People still have a huge amount of text data to train advanced language model to cover all this kind of tail case. If we really need to boost the E2E model to a next stage, we need to think about how to leverage all those text data. The second thing is how to deal with limited training data, even in industry, for not for all the languages, but for some languages, we also have very limited training data. However, E2E models are data hungry. We need to think how to use that kind of unlabeled data to improve the E2E model. Recently, there is a clear trend that the self-supervised learning. And the third one is how to integrate knowledge. For example, our E2E model directly can output all the kind of display format. However, when user says a quarter to six for the time, it's really hard for E2E model to produce 5 for 5 because it doesn't have the knowledge that a quarter to six indeed equals to 5 for 5. Finally, every day we have lots of trending words. It's so easy to add them into a hybrid system because we just add them into the language model. However, we cannot easily add the trending words into the E2E model without biasing. You can argue that we can just use a biasing list for the trending words, but every day we have a huge amount of trending words. We cannot afford that finally we end up with a biasing list with 1 million or even 10 million trending words. Then the attention doesn't work at all. So how to add new words without biasing to improve the E2E model for the recognition of trending words is also a challenge. Thank you very much for the attention.
All right, so thank you, Jinyu, for the great talk. And we are also happy to see Joshua is here, and Professor Larry Hack is also here. And please feel free to ask any questions for the talk.
Oh, hi, Jinyu.
Hi.
So I want to ask a question about the adaptation.
Yeah.
That I noticed that you mentioned that nowadays for whatever speaker adaptation and domain adaptation, use TDS data to do the data annotation and generate some specific data. It's one of the most popular and effective way. But one of the problem is that so nowadays usually some ASR system is deployed on device, for example on the phone or on some whatever HomePod. So may I ask, is that possible for to deploy a huge TDS system to generate actual data and fine tune the ASR system on device?
That's a very good question. And let's read, if we really want to do the TTS adaptation, we have to, lots of time, we have to put the adaptation on cloud. So basically you upload the model to cloud and adapt the model and then download the model. But this is not good. So especially for the privacy, right? Because sometimes people can not afford the model going out cannot going out of the device. Therefore, that's the reason I talk about some adaptation method with only text data. If you can just use text data to adapt your model, then the cost is small and your model, I think, doesn't need to go outside your device.
Yeah, got it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anxious.
Yeah, I think Andreas have a question.
Yeah, thanks, Jinyu, for the great talk. I was wondering, when you talked about the multilingual recognition,
yeah.
I think there's great potential for dealing with code switching between languages,
yeah.
You know, where people like in India or, you know, Spanish speakers in the US, they switch between
yeah.
languages very seamlessly. And I know you have some colleagues at MSR India that are looking at code switching. Do you have any work at Microsoft on using RNNT-based multilingual systems for code switching? Any results there?
Very good question. We don't do a lot of code switching. So what I need to say is that we just want to handle this kind of multilingual. We build a model to handle multiple languages. As I mentioned, if we can handle this kind of bilingual or trilingual, we can also handle the code switching to some extent, but not perfectly, because if we specifically need to handle code switching, of course, if we can have lots of code switching data during our training, that's fantastic. Otherwise, we need to think about, for example, data augmentation or other method. I think, we didn't on purpose, at least in my group, we didn't on purpose to handle code switch.
You mean you simulate code switch data from
yes.
multilingual data? Okay, okay.
Yeah.
And I have a second question if there's time.
Yeah.
Do you have any work on dealing with the problem that these systems, they tend to work well on, you know, the type of speech that's represented in the majority of your training data, but not
yeah.
so well on the, you know, speech of minorities like non-native speakers, for example?
Yeah.
Do you have any techniques for, you know, dealing with that type of situation?
Yeah, right now, so basically, we want to build a system good at not just the native speakers and also non-native speakers. So the easiest way is just to get all the kind of data.
Yeah, well.
Yeah, okay. Data is always the most important thing.
Okay. All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Yeah, any other questions? Yeah, Jinyu, I have a short question. So recently
yeah.
we all saw your paper on the wave LN. But
okay.
when the self-supervised masses shows a lot of potential on this speech in a really low resource domain,
yeah.
do you have some comment to deploy this kind of SSL for on-device application?
This is a different thing, right? So so basically, as I mentioned in the training, SSL is especially good at dealing with the low resource scenario. So basically, for the E2E model, because the size is compact, we always can deploy E2E model on device, right? The only challenge is if we have only limited resource, how can we build a high quality E2E model? And that's the reason I mentioned to deal with this kind of challenge. What we do is that we can just use the self-supervised learning to pre-train the model. And in this way, we can use lots of this kind of unlabeled data.
I see. So even for on-device deployment, maybe you can benefit from this pre-trained model, but for deployment, you will still leverage upon this RNT for different kinds
yeah,
of...
Yeah, yeah, yeah. The self-supervised learning is just one method to how... to boost your model quality, right? And in that way, if we talk about how to deploy something to device, then I think, for example, RNT or the kind of end-to-end model is very good candidate. But then we look at how to improve the quality of this RNT model. If we have enough training data, we just slow in the training data and train this model. But for some low resource scenarios, we don't have enough training data. We need to think all about this kind of pre-training and so on.
Cool, yeah. And any other questions? Yeah. It's good to see a lot of speech guy like virtually. Yeah. Especially for 2 years, like virtual ICAS with InterSpeech. All right. If Jonathan, Jessa, or Professor Larry Hack don't have any further questions, maybe we'll just end this talk. Yeah. Do you have any?
Okay. Well, hey, I mean, I had a question, but I don't know if you can answer. It's okay. About, like, I'm very curious about what you're picking your brains about the biasing without, I mean, like, the last point you mentioned.
Yeah.
So I don't know, like, are you, I guess you're working on it, but is
yeah.
there something you can already talk about a little bit?
Sorry, I'm working on it, but right now we don't have anything, any very effective way. I don't have, at least we didn't publish. So what I'm talking today, everything is published.
But I agree with you that it's a very important challenge.
Yes.
And
exactly.
Very much interested in what you guys come up with.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
All right. So thank you everyone for the attendance and hope you have a nice weekend.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye.
Thank you.